So it begins. Let's go through Act 1, 2, and 3 these next 3 weeks together. In Act 1, these are the basic steps of Act 1. We're going to take a step back, but I like repetitions, so let's begin with a little bit of our, you know, first seeds for understanding Act 1. So first of all, Act 1 is all about the setup and introduction. This is the act in which a character is going to be called from where they are into where they're going. So we're going to talk about what we call the calling or call to adventure. And this is going to be a separation from home, a separation from the former self, which is going to set up a journey into the new self, into a new world. And we're going to look at home, the home. What is the home that we're separating from? So last week we had some introductions. We went over some basic narrative models that we're using in this narrative unit. We'll go over those a little bit more today, but we talked about how this narrative structure we're using, Act 1, 2, 3, this full journey, is coming from a set of other structures that are below the surface. And so I want you guys to be aware of what those structures are beneath the surface. We'll be talking about them here and there so that we can provide more depth in what we're doing. So one of the structures beneath this narrative model is what I'll call natural cycles. This is kind of a poetic clock that's just back there. So this is our mind. When you think of the maximum amount of light and minimum amount of light, just a circle of max and min and max and min. Well, maximum sun is noon in the summer solstice, maximum light. Maximum moon, maximum light, full moon, right? Minimum moon, minimum light, new moon, empty. Winter solstice, the shortest day. Midnight, the darkest time in the day, right? So maximum and minimum, we can't help it. We just line these up in our own minds. The emergence of day just gets lined up. Sunrise just gets lined up with birth, resurrection, spring equinox. We see it all throughout our myths. Sunset, death, afternoon, old age. So we talked about this. We'll talk about it a little bit more. But this is just this poetic clock that's in the background, this alignment of natural cycles, right? So we see that flowers, the cycle of a plant flowering, we flower too. That's our puberty, right? So when we line up our sexual maturation with that of a plant, we see symbols of our maturation coming forward in the flowering, the symbol of which represents a plant's maturation, right? Sexual maturation. So this just natural alignment of these cycles, of human cycles, with other animal cycles, with other plant cycles, and then these cycles with daily cycles, monthly cycles, annual cycles, right? We saw the alignment of day, month, and year around maximum and minimum. This mortal cycle of birth and separation, and then death and reunion over and over again, okay? So we looked at these as this kind of natural poetic clock of symbols in the background. We looked at how myths are often working with this clock, building on this poetic clock, Osiris, Persephone, Inanna, Christ, Buddha, right? We looked at these and we'll look at them more as we go. Then we talked about mythic structures. We'll go over those a little bit more as well. The Hero's Journey from Joseph Campbell, Individuation by Carl Jung, The Nightsea Journey by Frobenius, Rites of Passage by Ganep. These are models, right? Ganep is looking at models of ritual transformation. Joseph Campbell is looking at mythic models, mythic journeys. Carl Jung is looking at dream sequences, dream journeys, or psychological journeys. And he looks at how they come together, how our dream journeys are poetic reflections, representations of our psychological journeys. Just like a movie is a poetic representation of the psychological journey of an audience member or protagonist. So from natural cycles of sun and moon and sky and nature to mythic cycles like Osiris, Persephone, Inanna, Buddha, to mythic structures like the Hero's Journey, Individuation, Nightsea Journey. And then we look at movies. We're going to look at a lot of movies, 2001, Star Wars, Indiana Jones, Pixar movies, Lion King. We'll look at how these movies follow these patterns. And then ultimately, we also will be talking about journeys, narrative structures that have been put forward by filmmaking experts like Sid Field or McKee or Vogler or Snyder. So we'll be talking about these cinematic structures. And this is where this whole course is kind of built into your education and expected. Whether you're here or there, somewhere else, you're going to be taught the hero's journey because USC has a Joseph Campbell chair in their film department, right? You're going to be taught this journey because it's so standard for movie makers, for screenwriters, directors, to use these narrative models that have been cultivated by people like Vogler and Field and Snyder. These are standard practice, common practice. Even if you learned these models when you're a college freshman and forgot about them by the time you are a master storyteller, doesn't matter. These models are common language, standard learning. And so the cinematic structures are a big part of why you guys need to learn them. But then we're going to go deeper. Where do the cinematic structures actually come from? You know, they've been inspired by movies. They've been inspired by story structures like the hero's journey, which come from mythologists, not just from filmmakers. And the people like Field, McKee, Vogler, all of them reference Joseph Campbell. They all reference Aristotle. They all reference these mythologists that came before them that are inspiring what they're doing when they're making sense of screenplay structure. And where did the mythologists get it? From the myths. And where did the myths get it? From the natural cycles. So we're just trying to make sure that we have an immersive, coherent, complete vision of what narrative is really about. This is the story of mortality. This is the story of the day. This is the story of the flower. This is the story of Luke Skywalker. We're engaging the same, what James Joyce called the monomyth. The monomyth is this idea that there is some kind of singular, coherent narrative model that's being used and many, many myths or many, many structures. And the debate will be, is there one story, one ring, one loop, one story to rule them all? Is there really only one good way to tell a story? Nobody's trying to say that, actually. None of us. No, nobody that is in this conversation, not Vogler, not Field, not McKee, nobody's saying this is the only way to do it, even though when people get mad, they're mad at people for saying there's only one way to do it. Nobody that's saying this is a good way to do it is saying this is the only way. None of them. In fact, they all love people that are messing with the formulas. Look at Joseph Campbell's stories. They're subversions of his own formula. When we did an event with Chris Vogler, we did it with Darren Aronofsky, who is always twisting the formula, especially at the end. It's not a positive, not always just a positive hero's journey. So, but what is this monomyth? That's what we're going to be talking about. Where does it all come from? And the reality is that a lot of it, the reason why there is a monomyth is because you can see an alignment of the sun with the moon. You can see an alignment of mortality with the sun. You can see an alignment of the flower with the plant's mortality with human mortality. And there's only one way to do that. You're not going to line up the sun and moon around the journey of maximum light and minimum light any other way except for to have the full moon, new moon. Maximum light, minimum light, it's always the same. Sunrise and birth and awakening, they're always the same. So there is a monomythic alignment of these original poetic of nature. There's a natural, unavoidable poetic alignment of nature. Sunrise is not associated with death. Sunset's associated with death. Sunrise is not associated with sex, with copulation, the going down of the seed into the earth, the going down of the sun into the horizon. That is, it just is. It's geometric. There are these geometric alignments. So anyway, so this is where the monomyth comes from. But the monomyth is not the only way to do it. You know, what if we're on somewhere where there are two suns or three moons or God knows, right? There are all kinds of different ways that things could align, but this is what we're doing in this planet. We're not saying it's universal. We're looking at what's human. Since before we ever, for millions of years, we've been conditioned by the solar cycle and the lunar cycle and the tides and mortality and sleep and wake. This is normal for us. Okay, All right. Quick reminder and refresher. We'll do a little bit more refreshing. This week, we're getting into Act 1, next week into Act 2, and then finally into Act 3. So here again is a reminder, refresher of these natural clocks, right? So here's sunrise, spring equinox. We looked at these. If you had not watched the introductory lecture, make sure you go back and watch one of my introductions to this alignment. And then we look at, this is an example of some more myths and how these myths line up, the underworld journey, right? So this, here we see Osiris going into the underworld and coming back, Christ going into the underworld and coming back, Persephone going into the underworld and coming back, Inanna going into the underworld and coming back. And we see this in alignment. We see different details of how this aligns with these different journeys. So we see, for example, Osiris's and Christ, we see examples and connections about how them going to the other world is sunset and their return is sunrise. We see Christ's resurrection associated with the spring equinox. We see on and on. This is not what today's lecture is about. Many alignments. I encourage you to check these out. This on the left, these are night sea journeys. These are journeys through the belly of the whale. This is Jonah getting swallowed by the whale, Hercules getting swallowed by the whale, Pinocchio getting swallowed by the whale. Going down, retrieving light from the bottom, which we associate with midnight. Frobenius associates with midnight. This is when things go dark and we steal light from the bottom. But what I'm saying is it's not just from midnight. We're stealing light from the bottom of the lunar cycle. This is when that crescent sliver comes back. We're stealing light from the bottom of the annual cycle. This is the, you know, after New Year's, the light goes out, right? The ball drops, light out. And New Year's used to be on the winter solstice. New Year's used to be on Christmas, winter solstice, New Year's for the Green Knight. If you guys saw that film, originally they were all in the same time. The new year, the renewal of the year is obviously when the light goes out and comes back. Winter solstice. What's the new light into the world? Christ, new light coming into the world at the winter solstice. And this comes from earlier figures like Mithras. So here you have here we have these journeys to the bottom, whether it's a night sea journey or, you know, where we steal fire from the belly of the whale, Hercules' hair gets burned off at the belly of the whale, etc. Or it's, you know, the fire at the belly of the whale is actually Persephone retrieving or receiving the seed, the pomegranate seed, which is not a pomegranate seed. It's Hades' semen. And she becomes impregnated. So this is the spark of life that she receives and that happens inside of her. This, when she's at the bottom of the underworld, it's symbolic of her gestation. So she is going to be pregnant. And this is that moment of that seed, of that spark. And in that same spark, this is when Inanna starts giving birth. This is that new life coming, the first spark, the first radical root coming out of the seed. This is the moment at the bottom that Osiris he's died. And now we have that first spark of new life at Acre, at the bottom of the underworld. So this is at the bottom. This is when we retrieve the fire. This is, we have that spark to come back with. This is the grail, the elixir, whatever that thing is you're going to save the day with and make a new day with. You get at the bottom, that spark. Anyway, so this is an alignment. We see these alignments here of these natural cycles with these mythic cycles. And here we see some major mythic theories, right? So the night sea journey in blue around the outside, the hero's journey in simplified form, individuation journey, Nietzsche's three metamorphoses, the beast of burden, then Ganep's separation, initiation, return. And then we see on the right, we see these movie models, right? We see the hero's journey again, but we also see Field and McKee in the next circle with the inciting incident, setup, act one, plot point one, all this stuff. This is all from the storytelling models of McKee and Field. And then inside of that, you see Blake Snyder, Save the Cat, and then the basic three-act structure inside of that. But this is what we're going to be working with. This is a bit of a synthesis of these things to keep us simple. This will be our narrative model. So we will go, and why do we go counterclockwise? That's because when we go back over here, look at sunrise. Sunrise is just always in the east. There is not one objective way to do that. We're just trying to do something that's consistent and simple for all of us. So when we look at maps, we're used to the east being on the right. we're used to sunrise being on the right. And that's why, that's the whole orientation. That's the reason. So we go from sunrise to noon to sunset, right? And that's the same thing that we're doing in all of these. Okay, so we're starting at noon, status quo, starting with the need that's being resisted. And so this is what we're gonna go through today. This is gonna be our model. But notice the red in the center, we're just focusing on the worlds. We talked about this in the last unit, and that's what we're gonna look at now, a little bit of a refresher of that, or in the first unit. What's going on here? There we go. Okay, so again, act one, setup, calling, separation from home. Okay. All right, so again, we start out in the normal world. So now we see where our first unit, where we're focusing on worlds, has set us up for this unit. When we start with a normal world and other world, this becomes the beginning of the story in the middle of the story. So we get to go back to all that good work we did when we were making sense of normal world and other world. And we get to go back to that and now bring that into narrative structure. So this is just a quick refresher of that, right? We remember when we were learning about Campbell, Field, McKee, Vogler, and Snyder. If you don't remember, go back and watch those lectures. They're there. They're posted for you, right? So Campbell's talking about the known world of common day. The social order is known. This is secular life. This is the social order. McKee is talking about act one and the setup. Vogler is calling it an ordinary world, a normal environment with limited awareness. This is the home base, the mundane, the world of everyday affairs. This is where we set the context and we get the background. And Snyder, you know, reminds us this is the world before the story. And we watched a lot of these clips. And then we looked at different mythic examples, right? Mythic normal worlds and other worlds, right? We talked about Jung saying we start in the persona and conscious mind and conscious persona. And then where we're committed and focused on our collective conventions and popular opinion. Remember the Lego movie, right? This is, you know, everything is awesome. This is collective convention, popular opinion, well-disciplined mob. Remember, you know, anything that's not organized and normal, tear it down, right? So for Jung, this is the known world, common day. This is the world run by the tyrant, hold fast, by thou shalt. Remember thou shalt. This is the monster of the status quo. This is the keeper of the status quo, right? So this is my favorite example of that in a recent film. If you look at the Han Solo movie, Solo, he is a mule, literally a beast of burden, a mule. A drug mule. He's running drugs. He's running illicit stuff. He's a mule, a beast of burden, literally. And he's working for this big, tall, serpent-like tyrant with all these arms. And that image, I'm convinced, is directly inspired by Carl Jung's image of the dragon hold fast. When he draws it, he draws this centipede-like thing with all the arms going down it. And this is his tyrant, hold fast. And so I'm convinced that the Solo movie is literally setting us up this way. Here's this mule working for this tyrant, telling him what he has to do, just defining his normal world. He's literally a mule. And he has to then confront this serpent and, you know, break the bubble, break his normal world, find the chink in the armor, which is the sunlight, which is this little piercing hole he makes, and defeat thou shalt. Anyway, so this is the starting place, this place of tyranny, this oppression. There's some spirit, there's some energy, there's some change, there's some growth that's wanting to happen. And it's being resisted by some tyrannical forces, by our persona, by our consciousness, by our collective conventions, by our popular opinions, by the discipline of the mob. This is the known world, the common world. It's all resisting change. And so Marx calls this the status quo, Karl Marx, right? And for him, the status quo is a capitalist oppression. Eliade, you know, they were talking about the profane world. The profane world is, you know, I'm a World Series, I'm a baseball fan, and my team just won the World Series. That is sacred. Bottom of the ninth, two outs, sacred. You're in a space where what you do matters in this meaningful way. But normally we're in this profane world where it's like, you know, do things even matter? The secular surface world. Hegel talks about the outer world. We all live in the outer world, but what about the inner world, right? So we go from these examples of these storytellers talking about the normal world, we leave the current world, but then we look at what these mythologists and psychologists are teaching us about that world. And this is setting up where Act One takes place, the situation in which Act One takes place. This is the above world, the world of light, day, sky, waking consciousness. This is the world above the waves. And we're going to go in Act Two down into the earth, into the dark, into the night, into the dream, into the unconscious, into the self, below the waves, into the world of death. I love this scene. I was doing research for this movie a documentary I was doing on Alien. And I love in the movie Alien 3, this whole place is a basement. It's a metaphor. That's the point. When they're in the ship and we go into Act Two, and now they're just running around in the labyrinth of the ship, afraid of the Minotaur that is the monster attacking them. The whole place is the underworld now. The whole place is the other world. The whole place is a basement. And then he literally makes a joke. It's a metaphor in the movie. So this is, we go into the world. This is the earth, the womb, the tomb, the underworld, with the inner mind, the inner circle, the secret space, the temenos, which is that sacred innermost chamber, right? This is the tabernacle. This is where the Ark of the Covenant is kept in the secret inner chamber, as opposed to the outer world that we all know. So we're going to be in Act One. But Act One is in the normal world. It's all going to be about leaving this observed normal world. Because we're called to the other, we're called to growth. We know, we feel the repression. We become aware of the repression. We become aware of the limitation. And we're going to go now into the world of dream, into the world of death, into the world of adventure, into the forest, into the land beyond. And that's going to be the domain of Act Two and the beginning of Act Three. And one of the ways that we need to make sense is not just this normal world, but our character, our main character, is going to begin in a comfort zone. It's not just that we have the normal world that is the Shire, but like, look at this guy.
Good morning.
What do you mean? Do you mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not? Or perhaps you mean to say that you feel good on this particular morning? Or are you simply stating that this is a morning to be good on?
All of them at once, I suppose. Can I help you?
That remains to be seen. I'm looking for someone to share in an adventure.
An adventure? No, I don't imagine anyone west of Bree would have much interest in adventures. Nasty, disturbing, uncomfortable things. Make you late for dinner. Good morning.
To think that I should have lived to be good morning by Belladonna Took's son, as if I were selling buttons at the door.
Beg your pardon?
You've changed, and not entirely for the better, Bilbo Baggins.
I'm sorry, do I know you?
Well, you know my name, although you don't remember I belong to it. I'm Gandalf. And Gandalf means... me.
Not Gandalf, the wandering wizard who made such excellent fireworks. Old Took used to have them on Midsummer's Eve. No idea you were still in business.
And where else should I be? Well, I'm pleased to find you remember something about me. even if it's only my fireworks. Well, that's decided. It'll be very good for you. Most amusing for me. I shall inform the others.
Inform the what? No, no, no. Wait. We do not want any adventures here. Thank you. Not today. No. I suggest you try over the hill or across the water. Good morning.
So the dream work on that couldn't be more perfect. You know, so basically, let's see, can I? Let's see, there we go. Okay, so, you know, that couldn't be more perfect. So on one level, you see, not only is he in the normal world, which is the world that's not Mordor, this is the world that's the known world, but he's in a known world within the known world. He's in the Shire, which is his people's known world, inside of the larger known reality, not across the wall to the other world, which is Mordor. So you see this kind of fractaling, this repeating pattern. So there's his known world, the Shire, inside the larger known world, which is separated from Mordor, right? Mordor is the other world, the other world. And then inside the other world, the innermost chamber, which is Mount Doom, right? But here, first, his first experience of the other world is simply to leave the Shire at all. So his normal world in this case is the Shire. And in this normal world, there are no adventures, nothing unknown, everything's comfortable. And so not only do we have a known world, but our character needs to establish his or her or their selves in a stasis. And typically, this stasis is going to be a kind of comfort zone, even if it doesn't look like a comfort zone, even if it looks like an alcoholic at the bottom of a gutter. But it's still a routine that they would actually just rather be in the comfort of their routine of doing their own thing than they would actually to change. They're still in the cycle, in a comfort cycle, in a routine of comfort. Even if it doesn't look comfortable, even if it looks like they're a bum. They're often characters are not just beginning in a normal world, but they begin in an inner state of normality. And that inner state of normality is one resistant to change. You see, Bilbo does not want to go on the journey. It's perfect poetry. But then what happens? The shadowy gray figure from the other world comes up and disrupts. This is the shadow trickster figure. You notice he's the fire bringer, the fireworks guy, the one with the fire stick, as you'll see later, his staff will have fire. This is a Promethean figure. This is a guide. This is a mentor. It's also a shadow. He's a shadow disruptor of this Shire coming in from the outside. Again, we don't need to always think of the shadows as bad. Sometimes the shadow is just that which is repressed and is disrupting that which is known so that we can see more of what's repressed, so that we can go on that journey. Sometimes it does it violently and as a terrorist disrupting the status quo. But sometimes it's a well-meaning mentor trying to shake us from our comfort zone. Okay, so the poetry is fantastic. Literally cutting, scratching against the door. His comfort zone isn't the Shire, isn't just the Shire. It's also his home, his hole in the ground, which is, by the way, inspired by burial mounds. But that's a whole other thing. Leave that for another day. But the burial mound is a womb. The burial mound is a pregnant belly. Literally in the comfort zone of mom's womb. Literally in the pregnant belly. You don't even want to leave the pregnant belly. That's how much in the comfort zone he is. And literally here comes the Gandalf scratching at the door with magic that is beyond, with a fire stick, right? Okay, let's go back to our share. Just a little bit more of a reminder. Let's do, we did that one, but just a reminder of what this one is, right? We see our guy in his comfort zone. Please go play. We're not just in the normal world, we're in our character's comfort zone.
This is a story about a man named Harold.
And the comfort zone is a routine.
And his wristwatch. Okay.
So here's his comfort. But the comfort zone is also, this is also the upper world of logic, of consciousness, not the unknown. Okay. This is, again, this is a place where there is repression going on, suppression going on. There are repression, suppression of dreams, of rights, of life, of the elixir, of talent, the repression of the press, of society, of self. What's really going on is we've got a wasteland going on. It might look like a utopia. The normal world might look great. But there's always, if we're going to have a story, it's going to be for some type of growth. Even if it seems like Camelot's great, there's a problem there. Even if it seems like Eden's great, there's a problem there. There's a lack of maturation. There's a need. Eden may seem perfect and like, oh, we've just got to get back to Eden. No story is about getting back to Eden. Even the Eden story is not about getting back to Eden. Getting back to Eden is to go forward, not to go backwards. So what we see here is the journey is going to be... it's going to begin in a place of some type of limited vitality. Something is being oppressed. Something is being repressed, limited, right? Whether it's a minority voice or it's some sexuality that's not being recognized or it's art that's being denied or it's the youth that's being devoured by an older generation that's not letting them grow. And whatever the case, or it's literally nature is being repressed by all of our deforestation, whatever it is, vitality that could restore and redeem and save us all is being limited by something. Suppression, oppression, repression. Maybe we need a... Oopsie. Why don't we give ourselves an example here? Which one is this one? That's a long one. Which one was this? Ah. Taxation. Taxation on lives.
I think it's our tradition. It comes out of a particularly painful part of our history.
Yes.
But it's been the way we've been able to heal. At first, it was a reminder of the rebellion. It was a price the districts had to pay. But I think it has grown from that. I think it's something that knits us all together.
This is your third year as Cambrian. What defines your personal signature?
No! No! Shh. Shh, it's okay. It's okay, you're just dreaming. You're dreaming.
It was me.
I know, but it's not.
It's your first year, Prim. Your name's only been in there
it's
once.
It's not, it couldn't be. Right? This is repression of a truth that's coming.
I can't.
Just try. Just try.
Do
keeping the meadow under the willow, a bed of grass, a soft green pillow.
You remember that song? Okay. You finish. I gotta go.
Yeah.
I just gotta go. I'll be back. I'll still cook you.
See the wasteland, hunger, lack of vitality, drabness, oppression of people, repression of people. And what's she gonna go do? She's gonna go hunting, and she's not allowed. She's gonna go hunting where she's not supposed to. What other story starts with somebody hunting with a bow and arrow where they're not supposed to? In the king's land. Robin Hood. Robin Hood, this is a Robin Hood story. Katniss is Robin Hood. She's fighting for the oppressed against the rich. Starting with her literally hunting in abandoned and off-limits hunting grounds, just like Robin Hood, where it starts his story often. So the suppression of the people, one of the things we look at with the Robin Hood story is a shift from just a wasteland where grass doesn't grow, right? Her fantasy is of a wasteland redeemed, a pillow of grass. Robin Hood shifts the repression, the suppression of vitality to a taxation story, where it's the taxation of people that's being used to take their freedoms, to take their vitality. The vitality is the money, is the wealth. And so the people, the serfs, cannot thrive in Robin Hood's world, because they're being taxed. It's a shift of the wasteland and the oppression of vitality that's characteristic of the beginning of a story. Something being repressed, limited. Even Luke Skywalker, he's being limited. He's ready to grow, but that ability to grow is being repressed by an uncle that says you can't grow. And so there he is in this sandy, dusty planet, right? This wasteland poetry. But Robin Hood shifts that wasteland to one of taxation, vitality to one of wealth. He shows how the whole story is an emergence of the recognition that taxation is the suppression of vitality. And of course, in some ways, this paves the way. The Robin Hood story paves the way for the American myth and the Tea Party and etc. Okay, so this is all fun. Let's say, you know, dystopia is obvious. We see the suppression or the oppression. But what about, let's say, somebody who's you know, a story of an alcoholic. Well, there's also vitality that they're limited. They're unhealthy because they're stuck in their routine, their comfort zone. Or we have a prisoner in a basement, right? Where the bad guy's imprisoning some, they see they're suppressing, they're repressing some growth, some vitality that wants to be restored. Or we have a story of a romance where the person that we meet is going to be a person that unlocks inner vitality that's not being allowed in. We're not letting it into ourselves. So Jerry Maguire, you complete me, right? So he's repressing what the woman he meets will bring out of him. This is how a good romance starts. We're repressing. We're not identifying with a part of ourselves that a lover will bring out of us and restore our vitality. Oftentimes for men, it can just be activating a heart. And, you know, there's a lot more emotions. Emotions can be life energy and vitality, which we see in dystopia stories as well. Okay, whatever the vitality is, whatever the growth is, there's often some type of suppression, repression, or limitation. Okay, so let's look at this world. Let's look at Act 1. Okay, so we're going to start with, these are the main steps. Act one is going to be an introduction and a setup of the story. So whatever arc there's going to be, any A to B story, we got to set up the A. It's amazing how much people can learn to hate characters while they're just being set up. I remember going to a movie to Doctor Strange with a girlfriend who's like, I hate this character. And it was the setup of the character to transform. Of course we hate it. We often set up exactly what needs to flip. So we're going to have a lot of setting up, set up what's going to flip. If you want the world, you want to show us what the world's like when it's fixed, start with it. Not when it's totally broken, but when it thinks it's great, but it hasn't fixed this problem. So start with the setup. Set up the world that's going to change. Set up the character that's going to change. Okay? This is the separation. Separation from the world that we're in, right? So we got to separate from the Shire. Separate from our comfort zone. Separate from the person we were before we went on the journey. We're called to do so. We're called into the other world, called into growth, called into transformation. And this is a calling, a separation from home. So we're going to now look at a few key beats, key steps in this journey. We start with the... Okay. So we start with the status quo. We set up, this is not, so this act one, all of act one is on the left. Introduce, separate, call from home, right? All of act one. But now let's look at the key beats. When it's broken up into beats, and these are kind of looser, do all these things that act one needs to do. But here's how it tends to go. We tend to set up the normal world, set up the status quo. The opening sequence is either an opening, you know, action sequence, but normally we're looking also for some type of introduction to what the world is now. What is normal? What is the status quo? Set it up so that we can change it and show us the problem. So if you set up the status quo with the problem embedded, we get it. You know, we're like, you don't even have to have the inciting incident. We know what needs to happen because we see the problem in the world. We see this character has to grow. Then there's going to be some type of inciting incident, call to adventure, increased awareness, some type of disruption, this big disruption event that's going to shake us loose from the status quo and bring us into a contemplation of, should I go on this journey? Should I not go on this journey? And this is the refusal. The refusal of the call, some different language for it, the denial of the incident, refusal of the call, resistance to change, repression. This is when we're repressing what we've learned. We're repressing this call to adventure. No, I didn't hear that kind of thing. And this is when we're dealing with our fear. And the fear we have about going on the journey is an expression of our insecurities. Our refusal of the call is an expression of our insecurity often. But when we show a character afraid to go, it shows the audience is now realizing how scary this journey is. The stakes are expressed by the fear. But then we're going to have to go. We're going to have to decide to go, accept the journey. So this is going to either be done with some type of synchronicity or a sign. Okay. You know, some divine sign or some overcoming, some point of no return. Maybe our world's blown up behind us and we have to go. Or maybe we meet some type of supernatural mentor or receive some aid. It's Athena is where we get the word mentor. She was the mentor for Telemachus in the Odyssey. Or this is, we meet Gandalf, or we meet Morpheus, or we meet Obi-Wan. We meet somebody who, you know, or Hagrid. We meet somebody who gives us a sense of confidence that we can do it. So we're going to go from being in the status quo, being disrupted from the status quo, and feeling called to go, but then having the sense of resistance and refusal. I don't know about that. But then we got to decide we're going to go. We got to have this overcoming. And that's going to often have some, you know, we get some magic arrows, magic shoes, lightsaber, and meet a mentor, or the world's blown up behind us and we got to go. And then we're going to cross the threshold. And this is when we go down the rabbit hole, through the wardrobe, you know, through the looking glass, into the phone, you know, down the, you know, into the land of the dead. It doesn't, whatever it is, we're crossing. And this crossing is exciting. We'll show you some examples of that. So it's some of our favorite times in many stories. And this crossing of the threshold is going to be when we are kind of like, you know, whether or not we like it, we want to or not, we are now committed to this journey. And this is what Sid Field calls Act One, and it takes us into Act Two. And we'll come back to next week. So let's talk about the first 10 minutes of a story. Who's the story about? Is this the one? It'll tell us, you know, we in the first 10 minutes, we need to know who is this story about? What is the dramatic situation? What is the dramatic premise? What is the dramatic question? And so we're setting up the arch plot in the first 10 minutes. And make sure you guys do your reading. There's a lot more detail on this. And what are the circumstances surrounding the action, the relationships, the characters, the landscape and the world? This is all stuff you need to accomplish in the first 10 minutes. And we've watched this clip many times, so I'm not going to use this clip again, but you're going to see, you know, you'll see that all this is set up in the first several minutes, first few minutes. We see this is the story of
Matt Lucas.
Hi. Hello. This is about my husband.
Right. So we're going to see that this is, we're going to learn, we're going to see in the first few minutes, the opening minutes, that this is about Jack and that the situation is that he's a jerk and he needs to not be a jerk, and that he is a radio disc jockey, that he is a big persona, an on-screen persona. So he's got a huge persona to crack, and he's going to have to learn to be a more complete person. This is immediately obvious in the first few minutes. So at the beginning, we're going to introduce the world, the world, the characters, the theme, and the arcs. Right, all again. We're going to set up the world, the arcs, the character arcs, the thematic arcs, and the arcs plot. So in the first 10 minutes, we're going to say, who is the story about? What is the, oops. Who is the story about? What is the dramatic situation, the dramatic premise, the dramatic question, the arts plot? What are the circumstances surrounding the action, the relationship of the characters, landscape, the world? You know, who are the world? What is the world? What are the characters? What are the themes? And what's the big plot going to be? You're going to set up all these plots and arcs. Okay. And we can see Eden as a perfect example. We see Eden is the beginning of the whole big Bible. It's the beginning of the Bible, beginning of, for whether it's you're a Jew, Christian, or Muslim, this is the beginning. Or Yazidi, this is the story of the beginning. And in the beginning, we set up Eden, we set up the world, we introduce the characters, this is humanity, we show the fall, and we set up the need for redemption. In the first 10 minutes, we know, immediately we know who the story is about. We know that the whole thing is setting up the return to paradise and reunion with God. We see the circumstances that this is the story, the innocent first humans in the center of creation with the creator. We see the landscape of the world. We're setting up the wasteland that needs redeemed, the sin, the original sin, the key characters, humanity. This is the setup for the whole big old narrative, Jewish, Christian, Muslim.